Thank you, Karim, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. Our first panel this morning is looking at a very exciting area of development in financial markets and the financial sector, that of non-bank financials and of what services they're bringing to new clients, new borrowers in the financial system. We have a distinguished panel for you this morning. I will be very brief and ask Walid, Khalid and Dirk to briefly introduce themselves personally and to tell us what they are doing to bring financial services to new customers. First of all, Walid.
Thanks, Simon. I'm Walid Hassouna. I work for EFG. I'm responsible for the non-bank financial services platform, and I'm also heading debt capital market activities.
I'm Khalid Elgibali. I'm the president for MasterCard for Middle East and North Africa. And we are focused on driving inclusion and creating a world beyond cash. And hopefully we'll tell you more about it shortly.
My name is Dirk, Brouwer. I'm the CEO of Asia International. We are a microfinance institution operating in 13 markets in Asia and Africa. And we really, truly focus on the bottom of the pyramid. We have about 2.2 million clients, and the average outstanding loan, which we have with all our clients, is about $160. So that's these are small size loans. We're very interested in all the developments in digital finance and trying to reach out and provide a better service to our clients with lower cost. Digital finance is going to provide a lot of opportunities, but it will also take some time, in our opinion.
Thank you. I want to bring out first, I think it's impossible to talk about this without talking a little bit about technology. So first of all, Walid, can you tell us how you are using technology to reach clients? What techniques are you using that maybe banks are not using to reach new customers?
Okay, so the first thing, we're using technology across the board. So it's not only for reaching to clients, but also for targeting those clients, trying to identify client profiles, trying to have the right target market, and also making our clients use technology to simplify the process of their way of transacting, reducing the cost of the transaction to the minimum. One example of this would be value. When we decided to venture into consumer finance, we started with an app. This was the first time in the Egyptian market that a consumer finance company would come to this market using an app. And the main reason behind that we wanted to make sure that the client will always have his accessibility to this solution at any point in time. Also, this will enable us to use a lot of the technology features such as geographical location and other things to target our customers and push them to transact at the right time. Another thing is the way we underwrite those customers. And we have developed internally an automation of a risk assessment process. So we would be the only provider in the region who would be able to decision a customer between 2 and 5 minutes. Accordingly, there is no process of manual underwriting that you might look at. On the other hand, this is for the consumer. On the other hand, if you look at factoring, for example, we are trying to connect with different players just to discount invoices on the way. So people would upload their invoices, get the money into their bank account without the need of a hectic process of documentation, stamping, and other things like that. So technology is a major thing for us. We still look at different ventures like insurance and other things where we believe technology is going to be the major advantage that we have. We just started a checkout online process using Valio with our merchants. And this is this was grown inside the company with the help of our partners, in which we can authorize people to use their value limit directly on different websites, and potentially in the near future, we'll be able to use this for marketplaces, the major marketplaces in the region.
Khalid, your company is at a sort of different place in the process. Can you explain how you're using technology to reach new clients?
Sure. Look, I mean, as a technology company, in the payment sphere, but as a technology company, we look at it across three pillars. Basically, how we can support our current customer base, primarily banks, financial institutions, to grow. But that's traditional technology. That's in the credit, debit, prepaid, commercial solution space. That's one. Second, how do we diversify and create a set of services that are reliant on capturing and recording data flows that then enables more innovative means of low-cost underwriting to drive financial inclusion, and I'll explain that in a second. And the last one is build, which is really looking at the convergence of the physical world, cash, and the digital world today with 3G, 4G, and 5G, huge access to mobile telephony, particularly smartphones, and so on. So that's very broadly the framework. Now, in this part of the world in which we operate, technology as a means to an end is absolutely critical. And what I mean by that, as low as 25, as high as 40% of the economies in, let's say, the broader Middle East and Africa region, including the sub-Saharan African footprint, is still in the formal space, undocumented, cash-based, low access to finance, low access to anything, and certainly unbanked or low bank. Technology that we're developing every day and actually using with our customers, with the governments that we serve as well, because our customers are not just banks. Our customers are also governments, non-bank financial institutions, merchants, so on. That is enabling creation of digital identities. That is enabling the use of biometrics, whether they're behavioral biometrics or actually biological biometrics, to identify and verify a customer, not at the level of the customer, but also at the level of the transaction. And of course, those are the ones that we know traditionally are thumbprint, but the future will be different. And we are creating those solutions for the future. The future may not be thumbprint. The future, some people say retina, I would say voice. With 25 billion connected devices today, estimated to become 75 billion connected devices within 6 years by 2025, there is nothing that prevents this from becoming voice biometrics. And the importance of that, I mean, we see Siri, we see Alexa, we see a variety of other applications of voice recognition and voice authentication. But the importance of that is that it addresses the needs and special circumstances of the unbanked, those bottom two-thirds of the pyramid, who in many cases are actually illiterate. Mm-hmm. But they can be technology illiterate and still be illiterate. So how do we drive that? How do we use technology to drive financial inclusion? And for us, that's really very important because financial inclusion is a driver of economic growth, it's simply put. So again, technology for today, that's the grow, part diversify, but technology for the future to say, what will the future look like? And how can we develop and lead on the developments of those technologies that will ensure that we also shape and create that future to drive inclusion of the bottom two-thirds of the pyramid?
Thank you. I want to sort of take a contrasting view with Dirk, where part of Asha's methodology is necessarily an analog technology. It's a face-to-face technology because there are people who are not able to use smartphones, for example, who are not connected to advanced technology. Dirk, can you tell us a little bit more about Asha's methodology?
Well, providing those smaller loans to these female micro entrepreneurs, we truly operate in the communities where our clients live. So we still have many branches, and those communities itself, we contact them and see them actually in almost all countries every week on a weekly basis. They will pay their installments on a weekly basis. To us, there's always a communication with the clients. This goes into groups. It's all still quite labor-intensive. At the same time, there's a lot of real client interaction. Now, what we try to do gradually is to make it facilitated for the clients and make it easier for them. We often now disburse our funds via some digital medium, if a payment system, like in East Africa, we use M-Pesa quite a lot for the disbursement process. For the collection, though, it's still very much a cash business. And that also has to do with the fact that our clients are still totally cash. I mean, well, despite the fact that we disburse a loan to them via M-Pesa, almost the first thing they do often is to take a large amount of that disbursed loan. They go to M-Pesa agent and take the money. So they still trade primarily in cash. And once that starts to change, and that will take some time, although I have expectations that it will go relatively fast over the next, but I still expect it will take about 10 years before our clients start trading amongst themselves with their mobile phones, effectively, and that they can buy goods and sell goods on a marketplace, basically digitally. And that's a transformation process which we have to go through. At this point, I would say about 100% of all our clients have a mobile phone. But these are normal phones, normal feature phones. I would, across the world, it varies a bit, but in countries like Ghana, where it's quite reasonably well developed, even there's only 10% who have smartphones. The highest penetration of smartphones is a country like Myanmar, and that has to do with the fact that when it opened up, the Chinese, they just roll out, loads of mobile phones came into the country. So those clients in that country didn't even have a normal phone. They just had smartphones. They don't have the connectivity. They can't watch movies, but they cannot actually transfer any money or anything like it. So what it requires, in our opinion, is a very cost-efficient payment system operating in the marketplace, where it becomes a transfer of money becomes almost at no cost. And if you look at it now, it's truly quite prohibitive at this point for our clients to transact. If you'd start transacting amounts of $10 or less, and we checked it across the world, it's only a few countries where you can do that without it becoming too burdensome. I mean, most countries, you still pay for $10, you stay 10%, so up to 10% in transaction fees. Well, at that point, for our client group, that's real, real money. If you go and pay for your Uber car in Nairobi, and it might cost you, 50 cents or something on top of the cost of the taxi, for many people who have that money, it's not such a big deal, right? But if you actually really have to live on a daily basis for $5 to $10, that's your budget for the day. You cannot afford to pay those type of fees. But I expect that it will go relatively quickly. In countries like India, actually, the cost of payments is fairly low. And you see also, therefore, the adoption goes much faster. But we're still miles away, in my opinion. My kids, they transfer money with little apps amongst themselves. It costs nothing in the Netherlands. And they pay each other even when they pay for a beer. I paid the bill at the bar, and now I actually pay you. And they transfer, when they stand there, it basically clears. Mm-hmm. So that's very efficient. So the technology is there. It's just a matter of actually introducing it, rolling it out properly in these markets, and then we need to have clients in our situation who basically have the devices which allow them to use that technology at a low cost.
I really agree, and I think there are some really insightful points here, and I just wanted to just maybe call out a couple. One is this syndrome that you described, that you digitize, but then it goes back and gets physicalized. Exactly. Again, right? And that's not only in your part of the world or that industry, that's across the board. We see that behavior happening with debit cards, mind you, with payroll cards, whereby it's digitized, but then it's the first thing that happens is gone and withdrawn from the ATM and becomes physical again. And that primarily happens for one reason in our minds, is that when the design happened for that kind of solution, it may not have had the end-to-end kind of chain in mind. It just digitized one aspect, but did not digitize everything else. And that is why when we look at design today and coming up with technology solution, and earlier this year, globally, we've actually appointed and created and appointed the first chief customer experience officer exactly for that reason. So when we're designing a solution, we say it's not just about technology, yeah, it's not about access, in other words, but it's also about users. Now, case in point, when I have a kind of make a distinction between access and usage, today, even in bank accounts, right? Within the developed economies, about 1/3 of bank accounts are either dormant or inactive. Case in point, mobile, banking, mobile wallets, etc. About 2/3 of these are 90-day inactive. So the technology is there, as you said, but if there's nothing else that they can do with it, obviously, it goes and gets physicalized again. The second point, but it's related, is low cost. Absolutely spot on. And that is why, again, Pakistan was the first market where we developed the QR code solution. It was the first in the country to launch back in August 2016, which brings the cost of acceptance in this mom-and-pop small shops down from a $300, $400 cost to $120 cost to now $2 to $3 for them to start accepting digital transactions using QR code, right? And similarly, part to that is the cost of the transaction itself. For low-value payments, government transactions, etc., we've actually guided the markets in which we operate to introduce a low-value payment interchange to bring it as close as possible to the rates that you're mentioning. And we do all of this in an innovation center in Kenya, in Nairobi, actually, which is jointly done by MasterCard and the Bill Gates, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, which drives what they call level one solutions, low-cost entry point solutions that create the usage, not just the access, so that we can actually keep the whole supply chain from user end to end in mind when we're designing technology. So I totally agree, and that's very relevant.
Yeah. No, because the point is that our clients in Kenya, for instance, they travel from Nairobi to go to Mombasa and try to buy some goods. They do take, when they travel by train or by bus to Mombasa, they will take their money on their phone. Mm-hmm. And it's a wallet for them, because it's for safety purposes. But when they get there, and then they actually go do the transaction, they have to go to a M-Pesa agent, which is also very available, very convenient. They get, and they basically take the cash, and then they trade in the marketplace, buy their goods, and take it back to Nairobi. Now, ultimately, where we expect it, will go, and it will be so much more efficient for everyone, is that actually that cash transaction doesn't take place anymore, and that everyone can transact. And that's, in my opinion, it's a matter of time. It's a matter of getting the right regulation in place for this to take place. So all the central banks need to be very engaged and very involved. And I believe also Pakistan is a good example, where Pakistan is very, the central bank in Pakistan is very keen to introduce it and to actually make sure that it works for the low-income people. That's the large part of their whole population. And these people will benefit even more, because they've ridden the risk of having their money and their houses, and as everything becomes digital, it saves a huge amount of cost, particularly for these people on a relative scale to their daily income. So if that is introduced and rolled out properly, and I believe it has to be in such a way that it's regulated and supported by central banks, then it can go quite quickly. But it still will need some time for all our, at least our clients, to have the devices to start using it.
I want to take a bit of a step back and understand the context in which you're operating. So three of the markets in which you operate, Egypt, Nigeria, Pakistan, they've had a difficult few years on a sort of macro level. So obviously Egypt we've had, Nigeria we've had a devaluation of the currency, slowing growth. Money has not been going through the economy as it should have. How has that affected your business? How has it affected the story of financial deepening? How has it affected credit quality? Walid?
I believe that on those type of economic conditions, the non-bank financial services would be of great help. So when you look at microfinance, for example, in Egypt, it has been growing more than 100% for the past 3 to 4 years because the access to finance for this underbanked or unbanked customers actually is increasing. The banks are not able to reach out for them because they are taking care of more more important things for them, looking at their balance sheet and their from assets and liabilities side, they're really worried about it. There was an increase in, there was a great growth in things like leasing in Egypt, specifically because in Egypt, this the leasing companies would have more power to enforce security in case of default more than banks. So even banks moved from, not completely, but they moved a lot of their portfolio into the non-bank financial services and asked them to unlend those customers because they wanted to still have a good interest, a good risk profile, so that interest rates would not hike. And accordingly, they wanted something that is more enforceable that they can use. So we have seen banks coming into the to leasing companies, allowing them better lines, more lines, less interest rate to unlend even their customers. So customer referral would have become was becoming from the banks rather than leasing companies going into this. Also on the consumer finance, we have witnessed, because when we launched value at just after the devaluation. So we have witnessed that we are providing to the market affordability. In a nutshell, every single merchant, every single brand, were very happy with this launch, because this would mean that despite the change in price that came after devaluation, people would still afford to acquire something like acquire their products. And we have seen the major players in appliances, in mobile phones, in furniture, willing to partnership with a startup, which is a real startup, because they think that this is going to boost affordability. This is, so in Egypt, what really happened, that the economic condition has pushed the non-bank financial services to provide services to people who are either underbanked, so the bank will not prioritize them, or the unbanked, that actually the banks will not reach to them, especially at those time. And on the other hand, the retail was very much encouraged to look at solutions that would provide affordable payment schemes that was not there before, especially when the price point of everything has changed by 100%. When you look also at supply chain financing, working capital financing, and things like that, you will find out that very small players would love to have access to finance, but they are not being able to be underwritten by the banks in a timely manner. So banks would definitely underwrite them because they're good credit, but this would require a longer process. So non-bank financial services would come in and provide a fast mean of underwriting and allow those guys access to finance. Once they build their credit, they become bankable. In the past 3 years, we have seen customers who started their business with EFG, and now they are working with banks because we will be able to underwrite them. They built their own credit, and now they are bankable to those customers. So if we're trying to move a lot of people from the underbanked and unbanked into the banking sector by having a lot of, by having financial inclusion of them. Even on our microfinance, we report all our loans to the credit bureau. So we see customers now that are that have been with our microfinance company between 3 and 5 years, and now they're getting loans that are more than 100,000 pounds, which is the cap for the companies in microfinance in Egypt. They're getting more than 100,000 pounds from the banks, and the banks are providing them with those loans because they trust the way we have underwritten those customers.
Dirk, How have you seen things in Nigeria and Pakistan, two important parts of your portfolio?
Well, economic challenges like a big currency devaluation, which we have seen in Nigeria, affects our business. Our clients are affected. It has a little bit to do what the cause is. A big event like this triggered this particular case, a recession in our marketplace. And these are the lower income of the society. It doesn't always have to be like that. I would say in other countries where there's, say, for instance, high inflation, by itself, that's not bad for our business. And that high inflation can be accompanied with currency devaluation on a very consistent basis. A country like Ghana has had currency devaluations of 15 to 20% per year for years. But inflation was very high too, and it's for our clients, it was actually, there was a lot of activity. But big devaluations do have impact. We're very much looking at the moment what's happening in the field with our clients in Pakistan. The domestic heating oil has gone up, which is a cost item for our clients, which obviously affects them. That will reduce some of their ability to invest in their businesses, in our opinion. But we haven't seen the impact. It hasn't really crystallized yet. For now, it's been fairly steady in our business. But big events like this can have big impact on their businesses. I mean, I think India is another good example. It's totally different with the sales tax being introduced. It had huge impact on our clients, and the demonetization had big impact on our clients. Where suddenly they didn't have money anymore. Mm-hmm. So that triggered all kind of problems for people to trade. I think the idea and concept behind both was, I guess, not bad, but the impact was much bigger, and it truly hit the lower income client groups who really were dependent, and particularly on those banknotes.
Walid mentioned something about the banks in Egypt trying to shift some of their activity towards a sort of non-bank financial model. Khalid, looking, you sort of work both with non-bank financials and with banks. Can you tell us what the interactions are? What can banks learn from non-bank financials? Do they see a threat from non-bank financials? How's this going to evolve?
Sure. I don't think, and this is not only a specific to one country, but I think more broad. But you know, it's not a. We don't see it as a kind of a zero sum game or a kind of a you know, one at the expense of the other. And that realization has driven us to establish a platform that we have globally, which is called StartPath. And StartPath actually brings the best cutting edge startup fintechs to the doorstep of these banks to say, well, here are a set of players in the same market that are coming up with innovative, cutting-edge solutions, whether it's in the area of AI, chatbots, a blockchain, a variety of other uses that can support your mainstream business. And what we are seeing more and more every day is different formats of collaboration. And that's what I want to really underline, collaboration. Because I think both together have a different and distinct set of strengths. And working together, they can actually drive that inclusion and take it to the next level. So we're seeing a lot of our banking partners in Egypt and otherwise get interest in putting up commercial agreements, strategic alliances, and sometimes even equity stakes in some of these startups. To say, well, how can we bring this technology and integrate it? How can we bring it on board to drive certain processes and make them more efficient or lower cost? And so on. So we're seeing a lot more of that collaboration, and we truly believe that that is a way forward, and that's why we sponsor that and drive it very, very actively. And technology has to play a role because it truly drives costs and creates efficiencies. But let me just rewind, and apologies for rewinding to the previous question because it was really important. And I just have a couple of things to say on this. You know, when you were talking about the Nigeria, Egypt, and Pakistan, I think a combination of geopolitics and economics have actually led governments of these countries, and more broadly, to keeping it very simple, to recognize two things. One is, how can they more effectively drive real efficiencies across those economies? And the realization that cash actually has a high cost that can reach 1 to 1.5% of GDP. So how can we truly use technology to drive digital? So it's not a flavor of the month anymore. It's actually a real driver, or can be a real driver of economic growth. But the second very important thing is that when you're talking about 4, 5, and 6% growth rates, which are not bad, actually quite good, coming on the heels of some stresses, devaluation related and variety of other stresses. When you look at that, I think the traditional question that has been asked in many of these countries is, how can we get those benefits that we all know are there, the macro benefits, down to be felt at the level of that individual who says, well, I can see that growth, but I'm not feeling it. Where is it? And again, I think Egypt's a very good example, where 2 years ago, realizing this, they established actually a national payment council headed by the president. And across many other countries, they followed suit and followed example, where a lot of these countries are actually saying, let us establish a national payment strategy. Not for the purpose of payments. It's a national payment strategy. It's not for the purpose of payments. I think it's a misnomer. It starts with payments, but it drives inclusion and bringing those economic benefits down to the masses. One example, because I don't want to kind of monopolize the conversation. One example, and I referred earlier to creating data flows and data records. We're creating an SME marketplace in a country like Egypt now. We've created a farmers network across sub-Saharan Africa. Now, these are previously players who were operating in the informal economy. But overnight, you actually capture their cash flow base, and I go back to my use case rather than access example. You capture the cash flows ins and outs. And effectively, you can use that coupled with properly written design algorithms and artificial intelligence to actually drive cash flow-based underwriting and give these individuals or SMEs and micro-enterprise, I mean, kiosks, access to finance, access to working capital. That's when they start feeling the benefits of real economic growth. Mm-hmm. So that inclusion being driven down through technology is actually, in our view, the way forward.
Well, you need data for that, huh?
Absolutely.
That's the whole point. Right. And I think that's the thing which, at this point, banks don't have, and at least not on this informal sector. I mean, the amounts of money, and it's all cash flow driven. There's no asset backed or anything. It's we lend purely based on cash flows. Mm-hmm. So we know roughly what each of the professions of the clients we have, what roughly they can earn with their little shops. So it's even a loan officer covering 350 clients, she will normally have about 20 different professions, and she lends and she knows exactly, oh, she's a vegetable seller, she makes, she's sewing clothes and things like that. What type of cash flows are behind it? Now, that's very important. That's very important data for us. So that data we use across the world in each of the markets, and there's variety of income streams. But it's very useful, and on that basis, we can lend to these clients. Now, broaden that, actually, and to think about it in a much bigger way, actually, if you can also follow the cash flows, how they actually go, when everything goes more digital, then you have a lot of information about that, and you can actually, then you can combine that, and you can extend it on a much more national level. And that's where I think we will be going in the next 10 to 50 years. And it creates great opportunity. And it creates, and I think one of the things which you've seen in the Western world in many ways is that actually the investment was made for the data. A huge amount of capital was put behind these type of initiatives to get to basically collect data, which over time will have certain value. Mm-hmm. And you don't see that as much, at least not in the markets where we operate, where actually, in my opinion, these payment systems, real effective payment systems, and which can be used by our clients at almost, preferably, zero cost, provides them with the benefits, and at the same time, sources and creates a huge amount of data, which we can then again all use. For tailoring the right services to these type of clients.
I just need to add something. I have a use case on what Dirk was saying. So we are able to develop a program to finance ride-hailing partners in Egypt. And basically, we were able to look at the cash flows of those ride-hailing partners and develop an algorithm whereby we can underwrite those guys for new cars to upgrade their cars, or even if they are working on those cars that they don't own. So what we have done is we started to look at different data points. When do they work? How long do they work? What kind of rating they receive? What would be the major reasons behind a positive or negative rating? And of course, we look at their income and everything. And we were able to underwrite more than 500 customers in 12 months. We were only able to provide 250 of them with loans. And the good thing is that there are no default rates on that program. So the algorithm was learning, it was changing, and we've been updating this. So we started first with 6 data points. Now we are using more than 25 data points. And one other step you can look at in the future is, why don't you look at the riders? Because now you have the data. Unfortunately, you cannot access the riders' data. But if you could access the riders' data, then you can build a lot of financing for those guys.
Yeah.
So basically, data is the new oil. So if you can share, and this is where the regulators need to look at. If they can provide the right amount of data and flexibility, and also share those kind of data under the right structures with players like MasterCard, like Asha, like us, we'd be able to come in and provide financing, provide financial services, provide solutions, and definitely we can reduce the payment cost again, because we look at vertical banks now. We would be very happy to reduce the payment cost for our customers if we are willing to enjoy some float. So this will help us if we work on lending customers. So everyone is going to have, from a different angle, a major benefit if there is a lot of initiatives on the regulated level, which we started to witness now in Egypt. There are a lot of changes that are happening. Hopefully they are happening on the right pace, so that we can, every player in this market would be able to provide innovative solutions that will make it provide people with access to finance and at the right cost.
We've got just a few minutes for Q&A, because I'm conscious of the clock. So do you mind if we just, let's see if there are a few questions from the audience. If you raise your hand, we've got some people with mics in the audience. I can see a couple of hands here. 1, 2. Can you bring a mic, please? If you can please say who you are and where you're from, and then ask your question. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Shabir Malik. I'm from EFG Hermes. Couple of questions from my side. The first one is, how do you see the competitive landscape? Do you see scale becoming more important for banks, or you see a landscape, you'll see a few very large banks and few innovative fintech companies operating in the same marketplace? My second question is on digital payments. It's a great technology, but what do you think are the key obstacles that is preventing explosive growth in this area? And my final question, I guess it will be just specific to MasterCard. In terms of MasterCard, when you see your competitive landscape, do you see perhaps anything beyond Visa and American Express as your competitors? Like, for example, could Do or Etisalat be a competitor for a company such as MasterCard? Thank you.
Thank you, Shabir. If we have any other questions, let's just hear the questions first, and then I can ask the panel for their responses. Another question here in the middle.
Hi, my name is Arif al-Islam from Mizan Bank in Pakistan. So thank you, panel, for a very interesting discussion. We are very interested in the digital payment space. My first question is to Walid. You mentioned your ability to underwrite customers within 2 to 4 minutes, I think you said, using algorithms and artificial intelligence. That's a space we're very interested in. I'd like to hear your experience. Are you already doing this? If so, for how long? And what is your NPL experience in that? I mean, you mentioned that you've been financing ride-hailing services and your default ratio there is zero, but when you're financing individual customers using credit scoring done through AI, what is your experience in that?
Thank you. Any more questions? I don't think so. So let's throw that over to the panel. So I think we've got four questions, one on competition, one on obstacles to rolling out new financial services, one on competition from MasterCard, and then one for Walid, but also perhaps for Usher on artificial intelligence and credit quality. Dirk, do you want to start?
Yeah, I think obstacles, I think as outlined before, I think is just access to these type of platforms. Yeah. At this point, there's not sufficient. It's too costly. And the banking sector itself has not been particularly successful in being involved in a large part, and in being particularly interested in a large part of the population. And I think that gradually will change when they get also easier access. But at this point, you don't see banks catering for about 80% of the population in most of the countries. And that's with more digital services that will gradually can be transformed. It's already quite a big thing if clients would have a bank account and can do things as a result of that. And that can, I think NBFIs can be very important in actually channeling that out much faster. So from our point of view, to try to achieve that is just a matter of time and a lot of effort. But I don't believe that all the banks will be able to transform as quickly. And it really depends on the market share they have in the consumer side in their individual countries. I think if I look at basically in Western countries. In Europe and the US, you see the big banks actually transforming gradually and introducing all those digital financial services in time to still continue to play a big role. But I'm not so certain that that's going to happen in the markets where we operate. I do think that new entrants with the right platform can actually be very efficient and very effective, and I would imagine that you agree with that.
Khalid.
Sure, just a very brief addition and then going to this thing. Ultimately for me, you know, and I agree with what you said, Dirk, ultimately for me, and I think for many people here, it's really about the value equation. It's cost of delivery versus the benefit that you get out of the end. Now, again, just maybe to repeat the kind of the obvious point is technology makes that possible. Technology impacts the cost positively. When I was in banking, I learned the word or the phrase the bankable population. Technology makes the target population the full population because it really reduces that cost and hopefully makes it more financially viable. So I think when we, you know, over time, whether it takes 5, 10, 15 years, when we see this convergence, there's nothing that prevents banks and FIs from actually penetrating this. So it's not the bankable population anymore. It's the includable population, just to use maybe inclusiveness terms. On the competition, and it's interesting that the usual names and the usual suspects were mentioned, you know, Beyond Visa and Amex, et cetera. We see these as partners, as market players, and who are participate with us in actually driving the same vision of inclusion and creating this world beyond cash. Now, it becomes kind of somewhat inadequate to only look at three or four key names who play in a pool, which until today in many of the developing countries represents only 15-20% of total transactions. So when we look at competition, we normally, and again, this sounds cheesy, a bit cute, but we look at cash. That's primarily the competition because that's what we're trying to change into digital forms. So yes, we look beyond the usual names that you mentioned. We actually look at the larger pool of transactions out there as the main opportunity. I wouldn't say competition, but as the main opportunity for all of the players, us, Visa, Amex, et cetera, any other brand, as well as FIs, as well as governments which are driving this much more effectively. So that's really the opportunity, rather than if we only looked at the names that you mentioned as the competition, we would probably be looking at market share gains at somebody's expense instead of market developments, which is what we're focusing on as MasterCard as a technology company. How can we develop the market? How can we grow that pie of digital transactions and use that to create the data flows, to your point there, that actually enables us to drive more effective financial inclusion, reduce costs for governments, and actually bring the benefits of economic growth down to the masses instead of keeping them at the top 20%.
And what you also do in that case, you formalize suddenly a huge chunk of the population which is not formalized at all. So you suddenly see streams of income which you can frankly tax, which is very important for developing countries, that they can have a proper tax base. And many of the countries where we operate, our clients are completely informal. The only country where it's different is Rwanda. Rwanda actually taxes low-income people, and it actually you can see that it has a certain benefit for the country as long as they do something useful with the tax income, clearly, right?
Thank you. Walid, you've got four questions, but the one on AI may be the most interesting answer.
Yeah, I think so. So I just want to add something on when it comes to competition, whether it's the banks or the fintech players. Normally, the new startups, the new fintech, because at EFG, we are also part of an accelerator, which is EFG EV Fintech. Mm-hmm. And we look at a lot of ideas that are really focusing on customer experience, customer journey, and efficiency. So normally, the customers, despite the fact we all believe that customers are very sensitive to how you price your product, but in reality, they are also valuing a lot the convenience that they get and the timely manner of different decisions. And accordingly, there will always be room for small startups to get scalable because the banks will always be there and the startups are going to be there. And those startups, 1% of them will be successful. And the moment they are successful, they will become scalable and become big at the bank. They still have their own way of doing this. So this is one thing on the competition. When it comes to underwriting using an AI, so let's start from the beginning. What usually people do to underwrite customers? So I come from commercial banking. So I spent all my life before EFG doing commercial transactions and underwriting corporate clients. When I started with EFG, I started looking at why don't we try to automate the underwriting process first. So this is before doing anything else. Why do we need to underwrite people for credit cards via a credit analyst? Why someone need to print out a report from the credit bureau, look at it, look at the demographics of the client and try to profile the client and assign a limit? What we have done as a first step that we started to actually put all of this into our loan engine. So we started feeding a loan engine with all the information that we assume that those analysts will look at. Mm-hmm. And accordingly, we went to a 20 minutes of underwriting process other than a couple of days with the banks. The other thing is that we started to use this algorithm to learn more about those customers. So we started to look at their payment behavior, what type of products they are buying, when are they buying it, and strangely enough, we find a lot of correlation between the product they buy, how much they are buying the product for. So if they are buying 10 mobiles, we understand those guys are actually seeking a personal loan, not an installment plan. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, in Egypt, no one can provide personal loans except the banks. So we were a backdoor for it. We've seen customers doing a backdoor for that. So we're starting increasing the learning of our algorithm a bit by bit, and now we'll be introducing a lot of other data points that include the mobile data, that includes social data, and we're still discussing if we need to do some psychometric tests or not. But on the artificial intelligence, we're improving on that. We are collecting data, all the data points that we need. We are actually helping our merchants to target specific customers that we know they would buy certain assets from one place to another. We also developed our own recommender. So now we recommend to our customers what to buy and when to buy it. So and to target customers, if we look at the look-alike of certain customers, we then try to define some target customers and try to push some very specific products to them, because we believe this is going to increase our conversion rate. And answering the question on default rates, our default rates are extremely low on this program. Unfortunately, I cannot disclose them because, you know, we're be doing our earning release in a couple of weeks, so I cannot disclose them, but you can look at our earning release and I think you will find a lot to see here, and it is actually very, very, very low. It's almost nil.
Thank you, Walid. We're reaching the end of our allotted time, so if I can ask each of the panelists to give us a quick 30-second takeaway. Let's start with Dirk.
Well, I see a great opportunity. I envisage that if we will be sitting here again in 10 years' time, that the world will be a very different place in the markets where we operate, where all our clients and the population at large will be interconnected. Maybe not 10, maybe 15, 20, everything always takes a little longer, but it just requires the devices, the connectivity, and the interest and the capacity for usage is absolutely there. And everyone wants it. And at that point in time, the amount of services which we as financial institutions can provide just multiplies. It can be done faster, lower cost, more efficient for the clients, and it will really transform, in my opinion, the markets in Africa and in Asia where we operate. And you just have to be sure, as a financial institution, that you don't that you are stay ahead of the game, or at least be fully participating in it. Because otherwise, I think you have a high risk of being gradually, marginalized.
Khalid.
Yeah, I'll probably pick up on a point that I said or mentioned in the last poll, which is really in response to the competition question. For us, it's about collaboration rather than competition. For us, that's the real opportunity to say, what does each of the players bring to the table? How can you get the best of each world and actually, in some way, merge them together and actually drive that inclusion? That is a big deal for us. And the vision of driving that inclusion to drive economic growth is absolutely critical. When you think of it, you know, almost 40% of the adult population until today does not have a formal banking or financial relationship. Imagine if those 40% can be productive, through access to finance, working capital, ways that they can grow their business, have a better life for their families if they're individuals. So how can the parties, whether it's banks, FIs, non-banks, NBFIs, technology providers, and governments, very importantly, because what we didn't touch on is the, and I think Dirk alluded to it, is the regulatory environment and regulatory framework. That regtech or regulatory technology, EKYC, authentication, and I think that whole end-to-end chain is, you know, to create interoperable solutions through collaboration between these parties is what's going to drive success. And frankly, the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow is pretty big and pretty attractive for us to focus on that.
I think in the near future, we are going to see a lot of financial inclusion. I believe that the governments and the regulators, as Khaled was saying, are have an open eye on that. They believe that the only way to provide the banked and unbanked with finance, the underbanked with finance, this is going to help them a lot on the growth rates, because everyone is trying to target medium and small enterprises and even very small enterprises. And accordingly, they understand now that this is not going to happen via the normal banking sector, because basically the number of players in any market on the banking level would be less than the number of non-bank financial services, and those non-bank financial services are specialized providers. The other thing that I believe is going to happen too, that there will be a lot of things changing the market very soon. We are going to see a lot of players coming into this market with small size, small tickets, and they would rock the boat. They would change what banking as we used to see it. They will even change national non-bank financial services as we used to see it by identifying the need and the right need for the customers and delivering it. And the moment this is going to happen, things are going to change. So for the coming 5 to 10 years, I believe changes are going to outpace anything else. And the organizations who are going to survive this are either organizations who are currently investing in those players or who are willing to adapt and change and try to be compatible with those changes as fast as possible. But we need more lean organizations, and definitely the regulator is going, they are going to go into like EKYC and other things. They're going to look at financial inclusion more than anything else. So this is going to help all the players in the market to grow and grow fast.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in thanking our distinguished panel, Walid Hassouna, Khalid Elgibali, and Dirk Brouwer. Thank you.